that was the starting point for us, and obviously its retention was seen as being key. I think one of the members referenced the size of the building, and for those members who were on site yesterday, you can see for yourself just how large it is. But notwithstanding the costs involved with the actual conversion of that scheme, because of the international, the national and the local importance that is attached to Birkenhead Park, we've had to negotiate with the applicant and Historic England quite detailed and high quality materials to be used with the new development that would be built at the back of the site. So the cost of the overall scheme is significantly higher than one might expect with a standard residential scheme. And indeed, Historic England themselves have acknowledged that. They say that you know, the external works and service costs have been priced at generic rates against measured quantities and are broadly in line with the expectation for a residential development. There are some high costs within the external works element in regards to the general arrangement, which might be explained by the negotiations between ourselves, the landowner, and Historic England regarding landscaping, repairs to the railings, and the overall materials that will be used with the new development. So there is quite a high cost involved in developing out this scheme. And that's really the bottom line, where in order to retain and convert 54 and 56 Park Road, you know, the level of development that's been put forward at this site is the bottom line to make it work. It is true that there is a 20% profit margin in terms of what the developer will get back from that, but that's in,
thank you, Matthew. I think on going on the site visit, it was clear to see that there was a real mixture of people said of some buildings being quite close to the perimeter line and others being set further back. And I think when I personally looked at this, I felt that the 8 metres close proximity to the fence line was quite close. In saying that, when I look at the artist's impression here, I, like Kathy said, I feel it's easy on the eye. I have personally voted myself in and out of this, and it's been good to hear other people have actually said on the committee. And Joe, you want to say something else, don't you?
Yeah, I was just keen to know, you know, the image that you're showing there, where's that come from, that image? Does that come from the
image? This is an artist's impression that has been generated from the, excuse me, from the plans that have been submitted by the applicant, yeah.
Because generally, if I wanted to hide something, I'd show that in the summer, where you couldn't see the buildings. So it's not going to appear like that all the time, is it? You know, obviously through the winter months, that's the way it's going to look. I mean, to me, I'm with Cathy on this, I think it looks quite pleasing, to be honest. Looking at it, I'll come off the fence, I'll say I'm fully in support of it, to be honest. I think it'll be an asset, it looks good. I mean, I'm a councillor for the Brombret, New Ferry, Port Sunlight, and we've seen a lot of buildings, I'm not saying, you know, go up in there, quite modern buildings. I think it is in keeping, and it's just looking.
Obviously, as officers, we've looked at this very carefully, and our recommendation is one of approval. I mean, it is important, I think, for members to understand that, you know, I'm just picking up on the point that you raised about in the summer you wouldn't be able to see it. When you're considering an application of this type, similarly to how we deal with green belt issues, it isn't just about whether or not you can see something, and whether or not it's screened or it's hidden. You know, the fact that if something is there, whether it can be seen or it can't, it still could have a potential impact on the character of a conservation area or an area as a whole.
Denise.
accessible space or a public garden. So it's historic parks and gardens. I mean, often in London you get squares where there are gardens in the centre of them. So it's that sort of garden rather than mind me a garden or your rear garden, as it were.
Steve?
Well, again, I think Stuart was hinting at the point down here, Scott, a reason to refuse them. It's clearly on the part. We've got a couple of members who have moved approval. My difficulty without hearing the reason for refusal, it sort of stymies debate a little bit, in as much as if we were purist about the policy, then we would have to say then eventually no development would be allowed in Garden or very, very little development. And that will be effectively, if that's what you're, I'm second guess, but if your refusal is about no development at any cost at all, the ultimate purist line, then that you may as well say goodbye to the Old Esmond Club or 56 Marlborough, because it will dilapidate over a period of time. 5 years is a long time for a very good building in a fantastic location. There isn't massive interest out there in that development. So if the reason of refusal are handcuff the committee to say that we will refuse any application in the ground of this garden, as I said, that building will not be saved unless there is some sort of sympathetic development to allow the investment within that. That's the real world we live in, the pragmatist coming out of me now. So I'll be very interested in what the view is and what that president would set. I know every application holds on its own merits, and we would have to be okay. But my instinct at the moment is to attempt in some way to keep alive the application somehow, some way, and look at whether the margins can be squeezed, whether the distances can be minimised. But that is not possible under the term we have. So we will have, I guess we'll have these refusal. But if they prevent any sort of enabling development in the future, that building will go, and we've got a play mushroom about that building. So I'm interested, it would really help debate Stuart if you could move those. I mean, I know fairly well about that.
Sorry, can I just ask a
specific
question? As the friend of the Old Head Company, can they not apply to the Heritage Lottery Fund for work to be done on the Ezra building to bring that back to space? Surely they could.
CH2, developments affected conservation areas, CH6,
information that we have on the late list. All those in favour of approval? Against?
How many voted in favour and how many voted against? From our perspective, it was a tie vote, 6-6.
6 in favour, 5 against and 1 abstention.
But the chair also voted in favour.
We had one of the members was actually out of the room.
This is an application that was subject to a member site visit yesterday. Planning Commission sought for a subdivision of an existing dwelling and the creation of 5 apartments. The site is located within the primarily residential area and also Wirral's conservation area. The principal policies for assessing these proposals are Policy CH2, Developments Affecting Conservation Areas, Policy HS13, self-contained flat conversions. The proposals have been amended to reduce the number of apartments proposed from 6 to 5 and the omission of the proposed first floor side extension. Therefore, the footprint of the proposals will remain as existing. The positioning of non-habitable rooms and the use of obscure bases will ensure no overlooking to adjacent properties. A rear balcony is partially screened by the slope of the roof and ensures no overlooking. Garden. The proposals also provide for 5 off-street parking spaces, which accords with the 1 space per apartment set out in supplementary planning document 4. The site is located within walking distance of public transport and local amenities and retains a large Victorian property, ensuring any impact on the conservation area will be minimal. The proposals are considered to be acceptable and are recommended for approval. There is a qualifying conditional objection. And in addition to the conditions listed in the agenda papers, there is an additional condition in relation to closing of 1 of the 2 vehicular accesses onto Lindale Road. That would be rendered obsolete as part of this development, and to ensure that would be permanently closed and the footway reinstated. And that's in the interest of public safety.
Thank you. Would the petitioner like to come forward to speak on this? If I could ask you to say your name and your address, there should be a button there that you can press it just a few screens. You have up to 5 minutes to speak, and I'll let you know when you have 1 minute.
Thank you. I'm Susan Evans. I collect the signatures for our petition against the proposed development of 16 Lindale Road, situated in the Nowells Drive conservation area. Some encouraging amendments have been made since the original application. However, this is generally felt and still felt as overdevelopment. The density of the habitation. The increased density of the population in Lindale Road is quite alarming. Where 4 years ago there were 2 dwellings, number 18 and number 16. The owner of number 16 sold the tennis court and a modern four apartment building has been built, known as 16A. Next door, number 18, is to be converted into 3 apartments. Now, with this application, within 2 years, the 2 dwellings will become 12 dwellings. The increase in the population next door, four apartments, this is the new building, the four apartments are over three floors with approximately the same footprint as this building. So you've got four apartments where there are going to be five now, but in the other building it's over three floors. On a conservation issue, removing three of the chimney stacks is contravention to the Melsbury conservation policy, where the chimney stacks of the arts and crafts houses are noted as an important feature. In this proposal, particularly, the removal will completely unbalance the elevations from the road and the golf course. The lack of car parking spaces in this development. I don't know quite where the one car to one flat came from, because the first thing that when I looked up the thing on the web, the parking standards portal and the planning, the provision of five parking spaces is totally inadequate for the likely inhabitants of these apartments. The government planning portal states that single bedroom apartments should have 1.5 parking spaces, two bedroom apartments should have 1.75 parking spaces, three bedroom apartments should have two parking spaces. This proposal would, in fact, because of one single bedroom apartment, three two bedroom apartments, one three bedroom apartments, would mean 8.75. One would have to be reliant on it or something. This lack of parking spaces is a serious matter. Is it evident by the development next door, where four places were provided for four apartments, and there are two residents' cars permanently parked in the road, not to mention their visitors' cars. Three of the parking spaces are to the rear of the building and the entrance for four of the apartments at the front. Logically, even more cars would be parked in the road. The pedestrian access to the rear parking is very narrow and dangerous, and there is no provision for visitors' parking. The emergency services coming down Lingdale Road, as they do in the summer, the fire brigade and things because of the beach, it's their access to the beach. Any house, the flats at the front have elderly people and they have residents, elderly residents, and they have ambulances coming down there. Anyhow, that's the service there. But in conclusion, it really is an overdevelopment. The additional number of inhabitants and associated services connected with deliveries, etc. Will become intolerable. It is dangerous. The children visiting the beach. It is just an overdevelopment. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Minister. Does the applicant want to speak on this? Would you like to come forward, please?
Might not be the right amount for the development, and as you've seen from the site visit, balcony area and further needs to be screened and hidden within the roof space. And again, the applicant will be happy to accept a condition requiring the detail of that balcony to be approved in writing by the planning authority. And that's it, unless any questions.
Thank you very much. Before I open this
other thing to take into account is that the site sits within a conservation area, and whilst I'm sure residents would welcome the additional parking, that in itself would introduce more hard standing within the site, and would therefore render sort of the greening, the landscaping of the application site less effective. So, having regard to what our own policies say around parking and one space for the apartment and the proximity to excellent public transport links, I would probably advise against the creation of additional parking spaces. But obviously, that's a good thing to do.
I think obviously we need to know that this is a conservation area as well. So, can I open this up to committee as well?
Chair, well, as we've heard from the petition, objection petitioner, the Ward Councillor, and to some extent addressed by the applicant's representative, the arguments are over perception of overdevelopment of the site, increase in traffic, off-street parking, and the cumulative effect of the numerous flat developments that are taking place or proposed in what is the far end of a long narrow cul-de-sac, which is very much a matter of perception. The traffic officer said, not a great many traffic movements, no terms of numbers, but in terms of the end of the cul-de-sac, it appears to be a huge increase in traffic. I have a number of issues there. One of them is that this parking policy, from sitting in the audience on other occasions, I've heard a short discussion of members of this committee questioning whether that policy was actually the right policy made at the time, and couldn't it be altered. So I quite understand why members of the public still think that this is right, say, maximum one place per dwelling just seems illogical. So I'd be interested to know where we are up to and possibly revising that to make this application, no doubt. Mention of the chimney stacks in the conservation area. I think we saw on site that it would be necessary to remove the rear chimney stack to put in the door and window. But I'm really wondering, is it necessary to remove the others? Isn't that just a case of taking them down so they're not there for to be a maintenance problem in the future? And it would seem to be the spirit of the conservation area to remove the very features which the conservation area was trying to preserve. And as was pointed out, the visit not only from the road but also from the golf course to the rear, part of the general scene of the houses surrounding the golf course, just as we were talking earlier about the houses surrounding the Birkenhead Barn. In terms of the parking spaces, yes, two more now added, plus the extra one on-street parking place brought about by the closure of one of the access points. But I do wonder whether it wouldn't be possible, as apparently has been possibly offered by the applicant, to incorporate something more on-site without being too detrimental to the green space, given that there's quite a large green space associated with this application site. Any of those items could be addressed. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Geoffrey. If you would like to come back on some of those points of the policy.
I can't advise committee where the policy of the circumvention planning document around the parking standards will be revisited. It's part of the process of the core strategy, which is an informal planning issue. As members are aware, the core strategy, the new local plan, is progressing and is moving forward, and policies are being worked up around that. So, but as we stand, we have a policy in place, the supplementary planning document for parking standards. I mean, as with any application or with any policy, it's open to interpretation and flexibility, and there is scope within that document for members to move against it if they feel that there are material considerations that weigh against the use of that policy. That's the way that we have to do each individually. In terms of the number of chimneys, the members who are on site on Tuesday, there are a number of chimneys on that building, and the majority of them are retained. It is true that some will be lost, but we do not feel that that those that will be lost will significantly harm the character of the station area. I'm particularly writing from in there where the chimneys will still lead as they do now.
I think that covers your
points, doesn't it? I think the cumulative effect of the increase in dwellings in the end of the
year. Yes, as the petitioner alluded to by the Board Councillor 4 years ago, all of those properties, with the exception of Lindale Court, the bottom left hand corner of the screen, were all in single residential use. And so in the last couple of years, a new build for those homes on site, they would have seen that four apartments have gone in there. There is an extant permission, I think, that was granted last year or the year before for three apartments here, and this is a proposal for five. So it is true that the nature of property